Hello everyone, welcome to my channel. This video is about congenital posterior urethral valves. I have given a clinical scenario along with the three MCQs with correct answers and explanation. Now first the scenario, an 8-day-old male infant present to your office with a 3-day history of decreased number of wet diapers and an abdominal mass noted by the parents. His mother states that he is not feeding well. However, he continues to breastfeed as he has since discharged from the nursery. He is having regular typical bowel movements. Finding on physical examination include a temperature of 38.5 degrees centigrade, respiratory rate of 30, pulse of 180 and blood pressure 70/40. He has an oxygen saturation of 100% on room air. He has sunken eyelids and diminished capillary refill. His heart and lung examination are normal. You feel a fullness in his lower abdomen. Now the questions. Question number 1. Which of the following is most likely diagnosis? A. Uretropelvic junction obstruction. B. Pyloric stenosis. C. Posterior urethral valves. D. Primary vesicourethral reflux. E. Duodenal atresia. Correct answer is C. That is posterior urethral valves. Most common cause of severe obstructive uropathy in children is posterior urethral valves. It affects 1 in 8,000 male. These are tissue leaflets fanning distally from the prostatic urethra to the external urinary sphincter. A slit-like opening usually separates the valve leaflets. These valves cause varying degrees of obstruction. Approximately 30% of the patients experience end-stage renal disease or chronic renal insufficiency. Prostatic urethra dilate and bladder muscle undergo hypertrophy. Vesicourethral reflux occurs in 50% of the patient, and distal urethral obstruction can result from a chronically distended bladder or bladder muscle hypertrophy. Renal changes range from mild hydronephrosis to severe renal dysplasia. There may be oligohydramnios and pulmonary hypoplasia. In this patient, diagnosis of posterior urethral valve is suggested by the decreased number of wet diapers, weak urinary stream, and palpable lower abdominal mass, which is likely his distended bladder. He is clinically dehydrated, as is often the case with infant with late presentation. A secondary urinary tract infection may also be present based on his presentation, but the underlying problem is the posterior urethral valves. Pyloric stenosis is a consideration, but absence of vomiting or a palpable epigastric mass make this diagnosis much less likely. Uretropelvic junction obstruction also present as an abdominal mass, but typically in the upper abdomen, and does not explain his fever and dehydrated appearance. Now question number 2. Patient is referred to the emergency department. A urine culture is obtained and he is placed on intravenous fluid and appropriate antibiotics. What is the most appropriate next step in this patient evaluation and management? A. Renal ultrasound. B. Voiding cystourethrogram, that is VCUG. C. Karyotype. D. Lasix renogram. E. Cystoscopy. And the correct answer is A. Renal ultrasound. With the suspicion of an obstructive urinary tract, a renal ultrasound would be indicated next and possibly desired before placement of a small polyethylene feeding tube in the bladder, as any finding of the obstruction may then be altered. Placement of a feeding tube would assist in bypassing any obstruction. VCUG will likely to be indicated in this patient to confirm the posterior urethral valve, but not as the first step in the management evaluation. Cystoscopy also will likely to be needed for potential surgical correction of the obstructing valves, but is not the most appropriate immediate next step. Lasix renogram would potentially be useful for suspected obstruction proximal to the bladder, and a karyotype is indicated only if there is an issue with ambiguity of the genitalia. Question number 3. The child is admitted to the hospital. An ultrasound shows bilateral hydronephrosis with a distended trabeculated bladder. Initial laboratory results are now returning. All of the following results would be expected in this patient except A. Urine pH 7.5, B. Positive urine nitrite and leukocyte esterase, C. Serum creatinine 1 mg per deciliter, D. Serum sodium 140, chloride 120 and bicarbonate 13 milliequivalent per liter, E serum potassium 5.2 milliequivalent per liter. And the answer is E serum potassium 5.2 milliequivalent per liter. In the setting of urinary tract obstruction, type 4 renal tubular acidosis may be present. All RTAs are notable for decreased urinary excretion of acid, causing an elevated urine pH and a hyperchloremic normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. However, type 4 renal tubular acidosis is typically associated with hyperkalemia. Also, with unresolved obstruction, serum creatinine is often elevated, and boys with posterior urethral valves may have high grades of UR and be susceptible to urinary tract infections. Given the patient age, he required hospitalization and evaluation for his urinary tract infection, as well as management of his electrolytes and correction of his posterior urethral valves. In healthy neonate, initial management of PUVs is the placement of a small feeding tube in the bladder and left there for several days. If serum creatinine level remains normal or returns to normal, then endoscopic transurethral ablation of the valve leaflet is performed under general anesthesia. If urethra is too small for transurethral ablation, then temporary vesicostomy is performed. In this, dome of the bladder is exteriorized on the lower abdominal wall. And when the child is older, valves may be ablated and vesicostomy closed. If serum creatinine level remains high or increases despite bladder drainage by a small catheter, secondary urethral obstruction, irreversible renal damage, or renal dysplasia should be suspected. In such cases, an initial vesicostomy should be considered. Now, in septic and uremic infant, life-saving measures must include prompt correction of electrolyte imbalance and control of infection by appropriate antibiotics. In this second uremic patient, drainage of the upper tracts by percutaneous nephrostomy and hemodialysis may be required. And when the patient condition becomes stable, evaluation and treatment of the posterior urethral valves must be undertaken. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel.